FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get 3 free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You are listening to and hopefully even watching the Financial Survival Network, and I'm Kerry Lutz. Today is December 17th, 2020, and we're seeing a nice little gold rally and silver rally taking place at the present time, and I'm just going by Kitco, so it's not quite up to the minute, but gold had been up as high as $29 the ounce. It's still up $22.70 an ounce, trading at $1,887.80, and silver, the big mover, is at $25.75, up 44 cents, but we're getting close to that 1:30 time in the afternoon when COMEX closes. Prices just, for some reason, just tend to trade lower into the COMEX close. Why would that be? Do you have any ideas? I'd like to get your opinion on it. Why don't you send me an email, kl@kerrylutz.com. That's kl@kerrylutz.com. Right now, our good friend of the show, Andy Schectman, is with us now. And Andy, it's always great to have you on. So, hey, you know, when I think of gold, I automatically think of you because I know you follow every gyration that happens every day because you have to, because it's your business as head of Miles Franklin, and you find him at milesfranklin.com, one of the largest bullion dealers in the country. You would be neglecting your job if you weren't aware of what the gold market's doing, literally 24/7. I guess you take weekends off.
No, I don't. No, not really. But thank you. It's a labor of love, and it is something that I'm continually watching because it is continually evolving, which is really the most important thing to stay on top of, is the constant changing of the trend. And Kerry, I've been following a trend that I believe has been unfolding since 2017, and it's continuing to unfold today. I think that change is certainly a common theme that is ever present, not only in 2020, but also, of course, in the precious metals market.
For sure. And we should state that this is your last interview of 2020. You are getting out of Dodge, literally, because you're in Minnesota. And if there was ever Dodge City, I think that was in Arizona, but Dodge City has moved north to Minneapolis. Hey, last time you were on, we got a question from one of our FSN community members, and they wanted to know, they've got a substantial amount of scrap gold. And many of these cash for gold places really rip people off badly. You know, you could have 18 karat gold, which is 3/4 gold, pure gold, and you could have a couple ounces of it. It could be worth several thousand. Well, a couple ounces could be worth almost $4,000 now, and they're offering you somewhere like, you know, like 2/3 or 3/4. How do you get a good deal on scrap gold?
Well, you can send it back to us. We'll guarantee the highest price in the country. If your listeners want to trade it for gold or silver coins, we'll make nothing on the buyback. When you're dealing with something that is not easily quantified, like 18 karat gold, you know, that's a scammer's dream, I guess, if you want to call it that way. If there are some people out there that are taking advantage of the public, I would argue there is. The ability of this is the reason why gold coins are so much better than gold jewelry when you talk about preservation of wealth, because of the liquidity side of it, the non-subjective liquidity. You can look at a 1 ounce gold coin and know exactly what you have. You can, I don't care if you're a jeweler, you drop a gold chain into someone's hands that's been a jeweler their whole lives, they can't tell you what it's worth. You have to do all sorts of testing and weighing and all that kind of stuff. So if any of your listeners out there do want to cash in the sterling flatware, they have the place settings, the jewelry that's sitting in a box that has been long since forgotten, what have you, we will assist your listeners in having it sent back. We do have the refining capabilities in our warehouse in North Dakota. We will melt it down. We will, of course, weigh it and tell the people what they're looking at if they want before we melt it down. And then we can either send a check and make maybe 1% on the transaction, or make nothing at all and provide all of that balance, all of the credit towards a purchase of precious metal coins or bars, a way to trade something that's sitting collecting dust that you have no idea exactly what it's worth into something that is non-subjective and can be utilized or passed on with great certainty that exactly what it is that you're passing on. So anyways, bottom line is I'm glad you brought that up. There are a lot of people who have a lot of this stuff that maybe they'd be better suited trading into metals, and we will guarantee the highest price in the country on whatever it is that they're sending into us.
Right. Yeah. So, okay. That's a good thing to know, because like these cash for gold scams, because the average person doesn't know how much their gold is worth, how much gold content there is in a gold chain, because years ago, 14 karat gold actually used to be 13.5 karat gold jewelry. And then the government pretty much said, if you're going to call it 14 karat gold, it actually has to be 14 karat gold. But really, it's problematical for the average person.
It is. And I think the way that a lot of these companies feel is that once it's sent in, no one's going to say, send it back to me. And so what people could do if they want, bring it to a local jewelry store, get an appraisal, then call me. We'll see who comes out higher. I'll make sure that we come out higher, because especially if they're trading it, we make nothing on the refining side. There's no reason to steal from Peter to pay Paul, I guess is what I'm getting at. And of course, everyone's in business to make a profit. And if someone were just outright selling, we'd make 1% on the transaction. But if they're trading, it's the same thing as a blank check for me. We have the smelter on premises. We have the staff that does this all day long. So it's no sweat to add a handful of necklaces and bracelets or sterling flatware, whatever it may be, and use that as credit towards a purchase. But it is a way to unlock, some equity that's sitting in a drawer or in a cabinet or in a jewelry box, and apply it towards some gold and silver coins that we can do for people. At the Financial Survival Network price, I'll make sure your listeners are always treated the best in the country, and I'll personally oversee all of that.
All right. Excellent. Yeah, I've got some jewelry I paid retail for in Hong Kong 25 years ago, 18 karat gold jewelry, a real heavy chain that it's just been sitting there. So I might even myself take you up on that offer, Andy.
Absolutely. Let me know. It'd be my pleasure.
Yeah, it's a couple ounces. I think I weighed it out. It's 175 grams of 18 karat gold. It's, worth a substantial amount of money. And right now it's like it's in the box, in the safe deposit box, just collecting dust. So,
well, and that's the thing, you know, you're someone who's in tune, Kerry, in tune more than most people. And if I said, what's it worth? You couldn't tell me. But if instead in that box you had four 1 ounce gold eagles or whatever it may be, you know what it's worth. And yeah. So that's one of the reasons that I like a deal like that, especially if this is stuff you're no longer using or wearing or what have you, is that you can convert it into something that's non-subjective, that I think deep down when people open up their jewelry box and see all that stuff or they're safe, they realize it's wealth.
Yeah.
But wealth with that is subjective and that is not immediately calculated is difficult. And even if you know what it is, convincing the person on the street, no, really, this is what it is another issue.
I know about that.
Right. So having something that's non-subjective in its place, I think is probably good advice. If this is stuff that's just collecting dust, why not? It's a good way to consolidate and to clean up and to remove the subjectivity of your wealth. And anytime you can do that, it's a good idea if it's just stuff that's sitting idle.
Absolutely. There's a lot of the way things are now, a lot of jewelry that you might have worn 20, 25 years ago, you're not even going to walk out the door with, because things are so uncertain and there's, so much more crime. So it's probably a good idea to convert your jewelry into real wealth and then put that wealth in the box, in the vault, wherever you hide it, as long as it's not in your home, and you'll be fine.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next.
Doré Copper Mining is a premier, near-term, high-grade copper and gold redevelopment opportunity with tremendous exploration potential only 14 kilometers from the town of Chibougamau in mine-friendly Quebec. Doré Copper is debt-free and owns a 2,700-ton-per-day mill with an 8-million-ton tailings facility ready to be used. There is already power to site, and it is accessible by paved highway and rail. Doré Copper aims to produce a profitable hub-and-spoke operation of over 100,000 gold equivalent ounces per year, or over 60 million pounds of copper equivalent by 2024. Because of the existing infrastructure and location, a low capex is anticipated to recommence production. Doré Copper trades under DCMC in Toronto and under DRCMF on the OTC. To learn more, go to dorecopper.com. That's dorecopper.com.
The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
You know, it's interesting you say that, Kerry. It's one of the realities of my business. And I think it's important to underscore one thing, that first and foremost is that I look at gold as wealth and not an investment. And where we are heading in a world where right now 35% of all the small businesses are unable to pay their December rent, 37% up in Canada, in the world where money printing by central banks around the globe is creating and repression of interest rates is creating illusions, that there are fueling speculation in the stock market and making governments look solvent. They're really not solvent, but they're keeping their interest rate expense so low that if interest rates were actually not suppressed, it would bankrupt a lot of these countries very quickly, the United States included. And we are living in an illusionary time, and it's sad that our business has done very well this year when look around and 35% of small businesses can't pay their rent in December. That's the backbone of this country. It does not make wearing a Rolex watch or a nice new necklace or whatever. I think it's wrong to wear that stuff these days. You're right, and it takes some of the joy out of a lot of the joy out of having a good year when you realize it's at the expense of people around you that you care about and an economy that you care about and a lifestyle that you miss and you care about. And I think it's important to remember that gold and silver are wealth. And, you know, what's happening around us is so illusionary that I fall back on 6,000 years worth of history on gold and silver. We're not doing this to get rich. It's not about return on your money. It's more about return of your money. And I think 2021, that'll come full circle. That will become more in focus as counterparty risk comes into play, as we see governments around the world do all they can to keep the balls up in the air, and it will become harder and harder and harder to do so.
Yeah.
In an environment of rampant money creation and manipulated interest rates and the distortions that those are creating, that environment is creating in all of the markets that we look at the periphery. So interesting times to say the least, Kerry. And so we will be watching with great interest as what unfolds over the next not only several weeks here at the end of the year, but also into 2021. And I would like to mention that I look at a pattern that we've seen now really since 2015 of a gold market that sells off pretty substantially into December as the bullion banks clean up their balance sheets and book profits. And then we see an escalation of the price into the first quarter of the following year. And for your listeners out there, and I don't mean to monopolize the conversation, I just want to show up what I've seen now going on for 4 years. I want to just encapsulate, since this is the last time that I'm going to talk with people this year, I just want to encapsulate what I've seen since 2017 and let people decide for themselves where this is going. This will take about 90 seconds max. And in 2017, I saw some real changes. And the first change that I saw was the German Bundesbank and all of the Eastern European central banks request to have their gold sent home from the Bank of England and the New York Fed. This is when everything started in my book, 2017. It was very unusual to see the Bundesbank make such a big fuss of returning all of their gold by 2020. In 2017, it was unusual, Kerry, because the central banks were net sellers of gold. But why want it home if you guys are all selling your gold? In 2018, out of nowhere, those same central banks bought more gold as a group than they did in the 60 years previously combined. Out of nowhere. Another. Wow, where'd that come from? Out of nowhere. In 2019, that trend continued and was up 90%. And then in April of 2019, as we've talked about ad nauseum this year, it's been what I consider to be the most important event of my career. The Bank of International Settlements, the central banker, central bank, the most wealthy, in the know, influential traders on the planet, recategorized gold as the only other tier one asset in the world, at least in terms of central banks are concerned, other than U.S. Treasuries. So now, after 75 years of it being treasuries, you have the most sophisticated group of traders on the planet recategorizing gold after their member central banks front ran that decision by about a year and a half and requested to have their gold sent home. Pattern is forming here. In 2020, this year, we see more of the same thing. Central banks massively accumulating gold. We see the International Monetary Fund request a new Bretton Woods. The International Monetary Fund is 190 plus countries that was formed at the last Bretton Woods in 1944 after World War II, that the same meeting that anointed the dollar world reserve currency, the same meeting that that formulated the International Monetary Fund. And now this same group of people is saying, we want a new system, effectively. And then you see something that I found very interesting and maybe defining for 2020, and that is what has happened on the COMEX market. We've seen over 330 million ounces of silver taken off the COMEX market this year. That's extraordinary. The amount of gold and silver that has been pulled off of the exchange. Now, think of the central banks. Central banks said, we want our gold home. Now, the people that are pulling the money off of the COMEX, Kerry, these are what is titled others. And on the COMEX market, it used to always be central banks versus the speculators, the specs. And all of a sudden in 2020, we get a rise of this group called the others, which we believe to be family offices, sovereign wealth funds, and billionaires. And here they are requesting to pull gold and silver off of the exchange, calling the bluff of the naked shorting commercial banks. Now, this is highly unusual. Very, very infrequently in my entire 30-year career would we ever see anyone pull gold and silver off the exchange. Most of the contracts that were issued on the COMEX were cash settled or just rolled over. Rarely would they ever request delivery. We have been seeing in every delivery month this entire year, more gold and silver pulled off the exchange than we would typically see in a year. And so I would argue that here again, the people that are pulling this off are the wealthiest people in the world. Do they know the people that are making the policies, like the people at the IMF or the people at the BIS? Are they in tune with the central banks that have been pulling back their gold from the Bank of England and the New York Fed? The same people who vehemently understand that gold is now a tier one asset? Do they understand and see things ahead of the crowd? And I would argue that they do. And then, of course, the last piece that I've focused on is, like most people, is this new reset, 2021, a meeting of the World Monetary Organization in May, titled The Great Reset. Put it all together and you see a pattern of removing counterparty risk, of pulling metal away from the exchanges and away from the marketplaces, massive accumulation. These are things that are very, very, very different. And I think heading into 2021, we will see more of the same. And I would like people to have one thought over the holidays, and that is that price is the greatest tool of misdirection. Price is what is used to throw people off the scent, and misdirection is everywhere. Misdirection is very pervasive. And I've been a big fan of the book, The Art of War. I've talked about it a lot. It's taught in every major business school around the globe, on corporate hierarchy and in every law school around the globe, on formulating arguments. And when you see it's mandatory reading at West Point, at CIA, the book is real, and it's lessons on how to beat someone without throwing a punch are pervasive. We are seeing misdirection up the yin yang and have all year long. Big money is misdirecting through price while they are accumulating copious amounts of metal and pulling it off of the exchanges. You have to see this for what it is. And the pattern that's happened since 2017. And quite frankly, I don't know what 2021 holds for us, but I will tell you, in this era of massive money printing and manipulated interest rates creating massive distortions in all of the markets, it's going to have an effect. And when I look at the main difference between the markets, I don't know that I've ever seen a time in 30 years where stocks, bonds, and real estate are all in a bubble at the same time. Because when I started in this industry, Kerry, they were inversely correlated, stocks and bonds. And now when, you know, well, back then you could put $1 million into treasuries and earn 7%, that's $70,000 a year tax-free, not touching your principal. It would take $10 million to do that now. If interest rates rise, as they already are slowly on the 10-year, and ultimately have to, you will see a spiritual experience in this country. And so we buy gold and silver not to get wealthy. We buy gold and silver because we live in a world of decreasing privacy and increased speculation across the board on all of the things that we consider to be staples of our retirement. And I would argue that the bond market is the mother of all bubbles, and the stock market and the real estate market aren't far behind. All of them, negatively or inversely correlated to interest rates. And interest rates will rise. They may go sharply negative before they rise, but in general, there's nowhere else for them to go as this unfolds, because either you have a Federal Reserve that continues to monetize the bond, as the rest of the world says, well, what are we going to buy bonds for from you guys? You're an insolvent nation. You're running massive levels of inflation and negative interest rates. Right now, it's negative real interest rates. But what happens when it's negative nominal? What happens when you know, you see interest rates at negative 2%, not 0.7%? And so at some point, the rest of the world says, what the hell do we want this paper for from an insolvent country when we're losing ground? They're inflating way more than the interest rate they're paying. They won't. So the Fed either has two choices: continue to buy, which is monetization, a la Weimar Republic, Germany, massive inflation, which leads to higher interest rates, or they say, we got to back away and just let it Mother Nature take hold. And then you see the greatest depression of all time. Either way, all roads lead to higher interest rates. May not be tomorrow, may not be 2021, but it's coming. And when that happens, it will be a spiritual experience. And these are the reasons that we own gold and silver, not to get wealthy. I don't mean to ramble, but I do think it's important to look at the big picture. I guess the one thing that I would also say is that stop looking at the news of the day. Do not get affected by the price swings. A day like today is a perfect example. Gold up $25, silver up 55 cents. You know, it's going to be volatile. And the same thing that we saw on the downside. Look at the fundamentals. Look at the big picture. Do not be so emotional. And look at this as wealth, not as an investment. Wealth you hope you never need to use. And if you do, you're damn glad you have it. If not, you give it to your children. So I digress. I will acquiesce to your questions. But I just wanted this to be said that I think this was a really important year. I think it's been a very important 3 or 4 years as these policies have happened and are happening right in front of us. And I don't think it's over yet, Kerry. I think 2021 is going to be a crazy year for people who own precious metals and a crazy year for people who think they're safely invested in what has always been traditional assets. And I think it's going to be a year unlike 2020, much unlike 2020, where, you know, I don't think it's going to be dull and complacent just because we have a vaccine on the horizon.
Yeah, well, I couldn't agree more. You know, we'll see how many people actually wind up taking the vax and what the side effects are. All these things, really interesting times ahead for sure. And I think we'll just leave it at that, Andy. I think you covered a lot of territory that we were going to cover together, and that's fine.
I'm sorry. I don't mean to ramble, Kerry. I'm passionate about this.
I know.
I care so much about you and all the people who I have relationships with. And thank you from the bottom of my heart for doing what you do. I'm proud to be associated with a fine person like you who is honorable and honest and is fighting the fight. And I say that with 100% sincerity. You know, and I think you should be proud of yourself too. You're helping a lot of people, and unfortunately, not enough people listen to us and are going to be caught up in a heck of a storm when all of this falls apart. Mathematically, economically, It has to, Kerry. It's just a matter of how and when.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, look, Andy, we've been telling people about this, you a lot longer than I, but I got podcast has been going on now for 10 years. And it's not like I've changed my theme. Yeah, you know, like when gold was going down, it's hard to convince people that this is where you need to be because it's the ultimate insurance policy. And now, unfortunately, it looks like that insurance policy is going to be cashed in. And if you have one, at least you'll be able to get something out of it. But if you don't have that insurance policy, then you're really, really in a world of hurt. So anyways, people want to connect with you. Go to milesfranklin.com. How do they connect with you and get info on different bullion you have available?
So all they need to do is send me personally an email, make sure they put the Financial Survival Network in the subject line or Kerry Lutz. And my email is Andy at Miles Franklin. I will personally review every single email and reply and make sure that your listeners get personal attention. I will make sure that they get the best price in the country. We have been running some specials lately on silver half dollar bags at $1.75 over spot. We have $20 St. Gaudens, almost the exact same price, certified, uncirculated, 62 and 3 grade at very, very, very close to the price of a gold eagle. These are really amazing values. You'll find, I don't think anyone in the country come close to them. But yeah, send an email at Andy at Miles Franklin. I'm happy to answer questions, reply back, or put you in contact with one of my brokers who will do so out of appreciation for working with you, Kerry. We'll make sure that your clients not only get the best service, but are also getting the best price here with the remainder of 2020. I will personally make sure of that. And again, that's Andy at Miles Franklin. We are the only licensed and bonded state in America. Here in Minnesota, you have to be licensed and bonded as a condition of doing business. And as a result, almost every other company in the United States won't do business in Minnesota because of the bonding and the licensing. It is it's something that puts us on a higher plateau or on a higher pedestal. We're held to a higher standard. And it in a federally non-regulated industry, it's important. There's been a lot of theft and fraud in this industry over the last 5 years, Kerry. Our reputation couldn't be better. The state of Minnesota doesn't care about our good reputation. They want us to be licensed and bonded. And with a $2 million surety bond backing all of our transactions, it just simply means that your listeners will get my personal attention, my personal pricing, and also the safest transaction in the industry, 100% for sure.
All right. And we always appreciate that. And initially, it seemed like a real negative. I guess anyone who's in Minnesota and wants to buy bullion doesn't have much of a choice these days because no one else can sell. In any event, send us your emails, kl@kerrylutz.com. Get your free newsletter. Go over to financialsurvivalnetwork.com. Andy, we will talk to you again real soon. Thanks so much.
Yeah, one last thing, Kerry. I just wanted to mention what you just said is what's called the law of unintended consequences. When government gets involved, yes, it makes us the safest show in town, but you're right. 99% of the competition has boycotted Minnesota. So if you're in Minnesota, you're kind of out of luck with the ability to find people to work with. But it makes everyone else that does business with Miles Franklin guaranteed to get the safest transaction, period. Kerry, I wish you and everyone out there the best of the holidays, a very happy and healthy, more than anything, new year. I thank you for all our time together this year, for your friendship. I look forward to picking up where we left off after the first of the year and see what the new year brings us. I am always here for you and your listeners. Again, Andy at Miles Franklin. Thank you very much, Kerry. God bless, and look forward to a brighter 2021 for us all.
We can only hope and pray, Andy, and thank you for your friendship and your support as well throughout this journey. Without guys like you, I couldn't have done it. And we never forget our friends on FSN and all of you. Like Andy said, Andy, happy, healthy holiday and a hopefully really great 2021. And we will talk to you after the first of the year.
Thanks for having me back, Kerry. We'll look forward to that. You take care, pal.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get 3 free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.